So, hi everybody. So I emailed Shepard. I took an Uber here. By the way, not to be a corporate chill, because I actually have no relationship with Uber, but I love Uber. It makes me want to start, like, it makes me want to start drinking again. Like, can you imagine how much fun it would be to be like a 25-year-old in LA with like Tinder and Uber? And I'm convinced, like, I want to see CDC reports, because I'm convinced there's got to be a spike in like venereal disease, like unprecedented. So, but I was in Uber and I was coming here and I was like, oh, I don't remember what I'm doing here. So I emailed you and said, am I interviewing you? But you were signing books, so I just found out that this is an interview. And so, okay, a few years ago, we went to this bizarre event in New Mexico hosted by Jeff Bezos, where Jeff Bezos rounds up all these odd creative people. Like,
that's the founder of Amazon, by the way, if you didn't know, if we weren't name dropping hard enough.
Yeah. Oh, again, no, the name is.
Yeah.
That was the beginning, the name dropping. So who else was there? Like Werner Herzog and Neil Gaiman and the tiny man who wrote Game of Thrones, who looks like a dwarf.
Yeah.
And
he looks like a guy that would have written Game of
Thrones. Yeah. And the best moment, though, just as a quick anecdote before the interview actually begins, Neil Armstrong was there. Do you remember this was the opening night, and Neil Armstrong, we're around a campfire, and Neil Armstrong told his story. And when he got to the part where he described landing on the moon rose in the mountains behind him.
They'd figured out the timing perfectly.
Yeah. Yep. I was like, so Jeff Bezos owns the moon.
Yeah.
But at one point, Neil Gaiman was interviewing Werner Herzog. And it was so interesting, because Werner Herzog is, by definition, kind of an unpleasant person. Very interesting, smart, but unpleasant person. And he was being real cranky, except when Neil Gaiman asked him questions about his childhood. If you remember that, and all of a sudden, like, Werner Herzog sort of warmed up and described what it was like living in Bavaria milking goats.
Right.
So that's, because we've done this before, so I thought, I want to talk about the book and politics, but I also wanted to talk about childhood stuff.
Okay. So I...
And the Pope.
I grew up in Charleston, South Carolina, and my mom was head cheerleader, my dad was captain of the football team. I went to the same school that Stephen Colbert went to, Porter Gowd. In fact, one of my classmates, Charles, I knew him as Charlie Simons. He's here in the audience.
Hey, Charlie.
But you know, my parents were pretty conservative, and they encouraged me to play sports and get good grades. And I felt restless. I was a mischievous kid. I was really into making rubber band chains and stringing them across the street so that cars would see something blocking the roadway. It wouldn't hurt the car, but they'd have to screech and get out and realize it was inconsequential. And then, you know, and
see, my friends, you know, and I did that with
an early version of, I don't know, it would manifest as culture jamming later. But anyway, water balloons. But you know, when I loved to draw from the time I was little and make model airplanes. I was totally into war stuff, which I'm such a pacifist now, but if it could blow up, kill, I loved it at that time. And a lot of my drawings were of aircraft carriers and tanks. I won the first grade art contest with an aircraft carrier drawing.
Did you play with army men?
Yeah, I did.
So
yeah.
Army men and models and everything, did you ever burn them?
Yeah, that was a little later. Yeah, I went into... being a pyromaniac later.
I think
pre-Def Leppard. Yeah.
I think that's just part of growing up, because my friends and I did the exact same thing. And like the most satisfying thing was like burning army men and watching them melt.
Yeah,
anyone else here? Like, here's melting army men. Yeah. I don't know why. What is it about, let's say, like when was it, 9-year-olds, 8-year-olds, that just makes you want to like burn things and blow things up?
Like, I think it's a little bit of, not to get too, I'm not a psychologist, but the idea that it's something that you have control over. And I, as a kid, I always felt frustrated that people were telling me, you know, this is what you have to do in school, you've got to do this, do that. And the idea that, I don't know, shit rolls downhill. Well, Army man, you thought you were going to stay a full-fledged figure? No, you're not. Yeah. You know, I'm dictating your destiny. And I think that those feelings of like wanting to control something about an environment, even if it's destructive, I mean, that can manifest in really bad ways when people, you know, I felt powerless as a kid a lot. It wasn't until I discovered skateboarding and punk rock, which were different from sports teams and my private school, where, you know, there were very, very rigid structures in place for how you had to do things. Did I feel a little bit liberated? And also, you know, drawing and painting for me were sort of a, it was more of an, just a technical exercise, like, okay, I'm looking at that, can I translate that in two dimensions on a sheet of paper? But there was no emotional connection. When I discovered skateboarding and punk rock, it was rebellious, it was visceral, it was creative. All of a sudden, I had, you know, not just this technical exercise, but something cultural and meaningful to apply my work to.
So I'm going to pretend that I wrote questions down, and this is going to be my pretend book. Doesn't it look more official?
Like right.
So, Shepard, it's just a blank thing, but what was the first punk rock song you remember hearing and where?
Probably Bloodstains by Agent Orange, because they had gotten the Skate Visions skate video tape, which was one of the first skate videos ever made by a company. Paul Peralta and Vision came out with videos about the same time. Agent Orange did the entire soundtrack for Skate Visions. February 15th, 1984, my 14th birthday, I went to get my first real skateboard. My friend had left his Dwayne Peters Santa Cruz in my driveway, and I learned how to tic-tac, and I thought, this is fun, I want a real skateboard. My mom said she would get me a board if I paid for half of it, so I mowed lawns and saved up the $60 out of the $120. And so the visceral association, euphoric association, Pavlovian association of getting a skateboard with Agent Orange as the soundtrack, because mm-hmm. they just opened the tapes up, that made a really strong impact. Shortly after that, I told my friend, like, yeah, I like this, I think they're a punk band, Agent Orange. She said, well, have you listened to Nevermind the Bollocks, Here's the Sex Pistols? I said, no, I haven't. And he said, bam, here it is. And that record was life-changing for me, because it was a really angry, aggressive record for South Carolina standards. Yeah, to me it was like, you know, the soundtrack to everything I was feeling.
Do you remember the first punk rock show you ever went to?
Yeah, it was the Circle Jerks in 1986 at a high school gymnasium in Somerville, South Carolina, which we all called Scummerville because it was the place where 13-year-olds tried to grow mustaches outside of Charleston. It was amazing because the punk scene was so small in Charleston and South Carolina that there were punk rockers from all around the state that drove there to see that show. And I had a real moment of clarity because I'd been into punk rock for a couple years, and I was wearing the ripped jeans and, you know, the flannel shirt around the waist and, you know, just trying to slam dance and all that, and gelled my hair up into a mohawk. And then I noticed that the Circle Jerks guys were dressed really normal. And then I noticed that every redneck idiot was slam dancing and trying to be tougher. I was like, that's why the Circle Jerks are dressed like that, because they don't want to be those guys.
I had my same experience the first time I saw Black Flag in like 82, is all my friends and I, we put on our best punk rock clothes and did the same thing, like took like egg whites and gelatin and made our hair stand up, and we were like, oh, punk rock, put on our little belts with the spikes on them. Mm-hmm. And there's Greg Ginn and
Chuck Dukowski yeah.
And Henry, and they looked like, I don't know, like associate professors at Columbia University. Like Greg Ginn is wearing like just like a button-down shirt, and none of them had crazy hair. And I was like, oh, okay. You don't have to dress this. I mean, I still kept dressing that way, but like. And do you remember? Okay, in high, because this was in high school, right?
Yeah.
Did you have? Sorry, is Amanda here? Hi, Amanda. So this is a question about girls, but it's high school, so hopefully that's okay. Do you remember your first high school girl punk rock crush?
Yeah,
we all had them, and they were all unfulfilled. Like the person who's like, you'd ride your moped by their house, listen to Joy Division on your Walkman, and just pine for them.
So, yeah, I had a couple of them, and I you know. The Cure, that was like the Barry White for punk rock girls.
Charlotte sometimes.
So yeah, you know, I liked a lot of really aggressive stuff, but I also liked The Cure and the Smiths, and that was went over great with the ladies. So I mean, not like it was pretty meager for me in high school. I was very shy, so but like you know that you could. You could talk about how your parents don't understand while listening to Morrissey whine. It was
Heaven
great.
Heaven knows
you know.
I'm miserable now.
Yeah.
I was going to make a joke about, oh, this is really mean. I was going to say, like, well, Robert Smith and Barry White could share clothes now. Sorry. Oops.
Close.
And so do you remember, because when I was growing up in Connecticut, you would go to the hardcore shows, and there would be, like, the three unapproachable, beautiful, amazingly cool punk rock girls that no one could talk to.
Yeah, well, that didn't happen until I was at RISD because there were so few punk shows in South Carolina that it was my freshman year of college where, you know, there were great venues in Providence, Club Babyhead, The Living Room, Lupo's. Mm-hmm. I'm sure you probably played a bunch of those places.
Yeah,
and there were... There was a really good punk rock scene in Providence because everybody driving between Boston and New York City stopped in Providence. So, you know, I saw Suicidal Tendencies, The Ramones, Bad Brains, Circle Jerks a bunch of times. It was great. But yeah, of course there were, you know, like you said, it's such a bunch of guys in the scene, and then there's a few really cool girls, and at the shows. Like, you know, the Cramps on the Stasic tour, wearing a Cramp shirt now. Like, you know, the guys who literally, like, lift the girls onto the higher speakers so they can watch from up there while they smoke and watch the show. And yeah, that was very intimidating.
And just being like, they were such goddesses.
I felt like a Weezer song, like, oh, that girl's probably got a tattoo and a pet snake. Damn it. Yeah. You know? But anyway...
And do you remember, okay, the best punk rock show you've ever been to?
Ooh, wow. Amanda, we've been to some good shows. What do you think? I've been to so many. Probably Bad Brains Quickness 89. Because it was at the Living Room in Providence, and Providence is totally corrupt. If you pay off the cops, you can get 1,500 people in a 500-person venue, and it was about it was at the end of the summer, so August. It was hot out in the venue. It was about 105 degrees, and I pushed my way up to the front, and then when the show started and the whole crowd is swaying, I realized I was being pushed so hard I could lift my feet off the ground without pushing my hands down on anything. And then I started to get a panic attack because I thought, if this crowd keels over, this is going to be like a Who show where people get, you know, stomped to death and suffocate. But then I was like, no, just take a deep breath, relax, it's fine. And yeah, mind power, it worked.
And that was right before HR lost his mind.
Yeah, yeah, it was. I mean, HR had, you know, he'd done the things like, Yaman, punk rock's Babylon, and stopped, touring. But then he was back, and it was great. But that was the last time I think they really did a full force show together. But you know, when I still lived in South Carolina, they'd recorded the video for the song "Eye Against Eye," which I think is an amazing song and an amazing album, at the living room. So for me, like being there at the living room where they shot that and feeling like, you know, hey, this is, yeah, this is something that I'm here firsthand. I grew up in South Carolina. I don't get to see these things firsthand, and I'm here. I mean, it might sound silly, but the idea that I could be a participant in things that were happening in the moment that were important, and not just a voyeur, experiences like that really made me feel like, hey, you know, I got a shot. I can, punk rock means you don't have to be a virtuoso. You can just you be passionate about it and have the energy to do it, and you can. Mm-hmm. You know, that was very empowering.
And yeah. So now, I mean, you've pretty much been able to meet or work with most of your punk rock heroes.
Yeah.
Because you've met everyone, you've worked with so many people, who of all of them were you most sort of intimidated by or in awe of?
Definitely Rollins. And I'm interviewing Rollins tomorrow night after the film that he's the
you
star of.
Just FYI, get some pointers from what I'm doing.
thank you. Yeah. you know, Henry Rollins. I've read a lot of his books. I've been a Black Flag fan since 1984. And I mean, the thing about him is, I always expected him to be intense. He's actually a really, really kind person. Mm-hmm. But he's also probably the most Spartan, disciplined, rigorous person I've ever met. You've done stuff with the Library Foundation. Mm-hmm. Rollins asked me to design the set for his show on IFC in 2005 into early 2006. I was working on it. We met. He was cool. We talked a little bit. Next thing you know, he asked me to be a guest on his show. I was incredibly intimidated, but I thought the interview went really well. And afterward, IFC actually approached me and said, your segment was one of the highest rated segments we did. And he had like, people like Gene Simmons and Steven Tyler and all sorts of people on there. Mm-hmm. So I was really blown away by that. But I think that part of the reason that I did well in that segment is that I wanted so badly to hold my own with Henry Rollins and not disappoint him. But he's someone that when he did his thing for the Library Foundation, I was pulling in favors because I think it's a good charity. I asked you to do it, of course.
I didn't make too many friends when I did it.
he read from the Futurist Manifesto, which is a bit fascist. So it's got some really brilliant language in it, and it really shows
how... It does have one section where they talk about burning down libraries.
Right, right.
I thought this was funny and sort of a wonderful QED of free speech. Like, I'm in a library reading something about burning down libraries, and I looked at the audience thinking, like, we're in this together, right? And we were not.
Well, you know, I mean, I took it more metaphorically than literally, but, I mean, the library was still standing at the end of that night, but But Henry, I told him, you just have to read from a piece of literature that's meaningful to you or from one of your own things that you've written, just anything really, and it's 5 minutes. Well, he comes in with, a thesis-level dissertation on the history of how libraries have democratized knowledge in America, and that they are one of the few examples of oligarchs making an altruistic contribution to society. And, God damn it, man, you set the bar so high every time you do something, Henry. Mm-hmm. I wish I hadn't witnessed this because now I just suck at everything I do. But anyway, yeah.
So your book, and by the way, these microphones are weird, aren't they? Like, I've spent my entire life working with microphones, and something about this freaks me out. because I'm accustomed to, like, either holding a microphone or having it be big and right here.
Right.
I don't understand how this works. But I can feel it. It's like this creepy little spider leg on my face. So it makes me feel a little stilted. But so this is your new book, newish. I mean, it came out...
last week.
Oh, I had a copy of it before that.
It was supposed to come out today.
Yeah.
It was actually supposed to come out today, so all you were here, right, you know, on the precipice of something huge.
Yeah.
And then they moved the date up by a week, so sorry about that. Totally anticlimactic.
So it's super dense, and when I was thinking about it, I was like, what? Like, there's specific things in here to talk about. Like, there's, you know, I mean, it's so interesting because there's a geographic component, there's the punk rock component, there's a spiritual component, there's a propaganda component. So here, okay, so rather than me find something, is there anything in here that you would want to draw attention to, that you'd want to talk about?
Sure, well, let me just explain what this book is. I've done a few books, that's easier when it's mostly pictures. I've done, I do some writing. There's some writing in there. There's some, I have friends who are good with words that will do things for my books. This book is my work from 2010, post my May Day show I did at Jeffrey Deitch's Deitch Projects Gallery in New York City, which was probably my largest commercial show to date, and it was the final show of that gallery before he moved to LA MoCA and was maligned by every critic in LA and New York for doing the Art in the Streets show that was the most successful show the museum had ever had, which I was in, but more successful than Warhol, Rauschenberg, Basquiat, all of that, not because of me. But I think
because you pretty much fucking crushed everybody else. Yeah.
But because of a lot of people. But anyway, I did a shorter book on the May Day show, and you know the May Day show was coming out right when Exit Through the Gift Shop, Banksy's documentary about me and several other artists, came out. It was also only 2 years after I had created the Hope poster, and you know it was a moment when I was a real lightning rod. You know, some people saw me as punk rock hooligan who'd made good. Other people saw me as someone who'd sold out. In the wake of that show, I had a lot of thinking to do because everything has its cultural arc, and street art as a genre had really been becoming, you know, more accepted. There was a lot of hype behind it, and I always categorized myself as, you know, a populist, a multi-platform artist, a designer, printmaker. Street artist was just one of the things, but to survive the street art bubble was some, and continue doing things that I thought were going to matter to people, especially after the unexpected runaway success and then the lawsuit around the Obama Hope poster. So I really just thought, okay, I need to look at the ways in which I need to evolve, and I need to look at the ways in which I should remain consistent. So this book, the title Covert to Overt, doesn't mean a transition from covert to overt, it means a range from covert to overt. So, you know, the idea of what's going on in this book is, I've maintained my belief in, you know, doing things outside the system, do it yourself, stickers, posters, stencils, all things that anyone on a shoestring budget can do. But I've also at times been able to, you know, infiltrate the system, whether it's the fine art system of galleries and museums, or the political structure, or doing things in cooperation with cities, not just at night when they aren't looking. this book is really a compilation of all the things that I think are important of the last 5 years, and it's chronological. They're all the shows I've done, but probably the most. I'm kind of like the Ramones in a way. Like, if you like the first record, then you'll like the next 20 records. I also think that there are things that I've been able to do that are not a deviation from, but a real amplification and evolution of my work. Probably the most significant thing in the last few years is large-scale murals. I always did my murals with tiled-up, wheat-pasted images that I could make Xerox things big and paint them in, and I could show up to a wall and in a modular way put together something to fit almost any space, but very quickly, before someone that wouldn't want me doing it might arrive. And but then, as a result of doing that for years and people saying, I like it, eventually people who owned property, maybe they didn't own property at the beginning of my career, but at that point they did, which is the great thing about getting older, People die, younger people inherit things, they like my art, so, people become successful. That's amazing. The opportunities that come my way to do these bigger murals. So I learned how to paint murals. I mean, I studied painting and illustration, but I never learned how to do things larger scale until about 5 or 6 years ago. But I've done, I did the largest mural in Detroit in May. It's 185 feet wide by high by almost 60 feet wide. I just finished a mural in Jersey City that's 143 by 38. These things, they change the landscape and they change people's experience with the landscape. So documenting that work, not only the end result, but the process is a big, big part of this book. And I think that all it is it's blue collar work. It's not because I have the most lyrical brushstroke in the world or I have the most original ideas or visual language, but I'm able to do something that I think is impactful to people because I'm just willing to do the work that it takes.
So in the book, and I know it, it's sometimes hard to pick, it's hard to pick favorites because there's so much work in here, but not necessarily picking a favorite, but is there something in here that you have this sort of the most tender emotional connection to? Like, is there one, a mural or any piece of art in here that, that you have the most tender feelings for?
I mean, everything is, it's so exciting when I'm in the middle of the conquest, mm-hmm. But then it's the next day, time for a new love, there's my wife, three stories high. It's pretty cool to get to do things with her. She's been such an amazing partner for me, and she's a great subject for my work. So, that's pretty special to me. But probably this image, it's Nelson Mandela, and this is in Johannesburg. I think, eight stories. I wish I had the stuff up there, but you're all getting the book, right? So. Yeah, this is like when iTunes lets you hear the first 15 seconds. But you can't download this. Capitalism, that's all I think about. But the Mandela thing was really meaningful for me because one, I think he was a really inspiring person, but two, I have a friend who's from South Africa, who told me a story about this thing called the Purple Rain protest, and it was toward the end of apartheid in 1989, Mandela was still in jail. No one knew how soon or if he would be released. And it was illegal to protest at all. So the way that the police would deal with protesters is put purple dye in water cannons, and anyone that was shot with the water with the purple dye in it and ended up with purple on them would then be arrested in the aftermath if they didn't, you know, hide indoors somewhere. But at this one protest, a protester was able to jump up on one of the water cannons and turn it around on the police, and then the narrative became, we're all purple, like we're all people. And so in that mural, it says, the purple shall govern. And I did Mandela in golds and purples, not because he was a Lakers fan, but because of that. And to do that and have people from Johannesburg come to me and tell me how much it meant to them, and there's still a lot of poverty there, and there's still a lot of race and class division, but there's a lot of healing too. And the U.S. ambassador, Patrick Gaspard, a really amazing guy, and invited me to do a talk, and brought a bunch of the artists, musicians, professors, and people from the suburbs that were gated to Soweto, where Mandela's from. All together, I just thought, art's a healing thing. Yeah, it meant a lot.
Okay, so going back a little bit, do you remember the first time you saw someone else's art and it had a meaningful impact on you? Like going back to whether this is elementary school or junior high school?
It's such a cliche, but I think one of my relatives had a Monet book, and the idea of that these things as abstract brushstrokes were pleasing, but it also, if you squinted your eyes, made something that felt almost photographic. I was fascinated by that technically, how these these various qualities of the piece kind of came together harmoniously when if you just deconstructed the ingredients, it didn't seem like it should work. That was fascinating to me. But really, that was more technical. Emotionally, Jamie Reed's art for the Sex Pistols, God Save the Queen, Pretty Vacant, Never Mind the Bollocks, Here's the Sex Pistols, Raymond Pettibone's art for Black Flag, and then Winston Smith's art for the Dead Kennedys. Those things were very impactful to me because, you're listening to something that really grabs you, and then here is the visual counterpart, and all of that wrapped together is sort of like its own amazing ecosystem. I felt like punk rock had its own economy, its own world, like its own language, all of these things. And a lot of the visuals that went with that, because I also associated punk rock with the act of skateboarding, which was such an incredibly amazing release for me. It was so liberating. All of it together definitely made a strong impact. But in the vein of Winston Smith, I did a year of art high school at the Idlewild School of Music and the Arts in the San Jacinto Mountains above Palm Springs. I was supposed to go to the North Carolina School of the Arts. My parents had said, we don't want you going to public school anymore. You're hanging out with the wrong crowd. Mm-hmm. And I was like, I'm creating the wrong crowd. I love it. But I was always like, well, I just went along with what they said to do, Mom. I'm sorry. that was a lie, though. But we took a trip from Idlewild, this is 1987, into L.A. to go to the Geffen, MoCA, the contemporary, which has been fairly permanent,
On Grand Street.
Exactly. And it had a pop art survey, and it was Rauschenberg and Rosenquist and people I was definitely interested in seeing. But when we took the bus there, going through downtown LA, there were all these posters of Ronald Reagan painted unflatteringly that said Contra above and Diction below. And it was during Iran-Contragate.
Who did? I remember. And then they...
Robbie Canal.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
Yeah.
And who else? I mean, there was like... So it's like that for years and years, it's like recurring thing, like different Republican politicians.
Yes. Yeah.
Speaking of Republican politicians, can I quickly tell you my Pope story?
Yeah. So yeah, this is not Pope fiction at all. This is true, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
So we were talking backstage, and he said he was going to save this for now. But Moby's band in high school was the Vatican Commandos. He's wearing the shirt. Not a totally reverent name for Catholics, probably, but. He was invited to, the Pope was Led Zeppelin or U2, and you were the opening act, right?
Yeah.
That was kind of
so
the idea.
I had a couple of weeks ago, a friend of ours, Laura Dawn, emailed me and said, did I want to play at a climate change rally in D.C. on the Mall? Not like the Beverly Center, but like the Mall in D.C. And I would be going on before the Pope. And I was like, fuck yeah, of course I want to. I mean, I'm not Catholic, I'm pro-choice, but sure, the Pope's environmentalist. Great.
Yeah.
And so I signed up for it, and then I showed up at the event, and here's where it gets interesting. John Boehner and the Republicans built a 10-foot-tall black fence, not personally, like I don't think Boehner and those guys are out there like hammering, but they had this 10-foot-tall black fence built that was a half mile long, keeping people from going to the climate change rally. And the day before, they told the Vatican security that they couldn't protect the Pope if he went to this climate change rally. And then they had all the congressional staffers waiting by all the subway stations near the climate change rally and shepherded them away from the climate change rally to the Capitol. So there were still like 70,000 people that they shepherded away from the climate change rally, mm-hmm. and about 5,000 people at the climate change rally, and the Republicans prevented the Pope from speaking at it because they were doing everything in their power. They didn't want the visual of him on stage at a climate change rally. So, you know what? Republicans are just fucking evil.
Yeah.
Sorry, if you're a Republican, you're here. Yeah. I'm not going to apologize. There might be some nice Republicans, but Republicans, leaders, and politicians are just scum of the earth as far as I'm concerned.
Well, I mean, the global warming's just God's retribution for us perpetuating the myth of climate change.
So. Yeah. And I know we're supposed to be like all like nice and tolerant, but like, just did anyone by any chance hear what Ben Carson said today? It made me insane. He said that he's never seen a bullet wound that's more offensive than losing the right to bear arms. Basically what he said was, the kids who died in Newtown, that's less offensive than someone losing the right to own a gun. Yeah, it's like, makes me crazy. So, the political side of your work.
Yeah.
It's one thing, so when we were in New Mexico with Werner Herzog and Jeff Bezos, just to drop names, and you gave a presentation of your work. And one of the things I found really interesting, because so much of your work has a really like fascinating confrontational, political, almost propaganda component to it. Mm-hmm. And when you were presenting your work, I was able to sort of decontextualize it and see it for its aesthetic merits. And all of a sudden, I'm not just saying this because we're friends and we're sitting here, but like there's such a beauty to it. Like separate from the political part, separate from the messaging and the sort of semiotics, there's just a beauty to the work that you do, you know?
Thank you.
The question that I have is, how comfortable are you doing work that has aesthetic merit and beauty without sort of like a political message or a propaganda quality to it?
Not very. and that, well, maybe it's my love of Bob Marley, Bob Dylan, Johnny Cash, Neil Young, The Clash, Public Enemy, Rage Against the Machine even, that people who have chosen to try to make something that was, you know, worked as art sonically, aesthetically, but also to share a point of view that was about, you know, making the world better, about justice, fairness, equality. And, you know, there's so many ways, large and small, that can be accomplished through art, but just making visually pleasing pictures is not enough for me. Sometimes my work is more decorative, and it might just have a subtle peace sign in it or something about justice in it, and it's mostly that small element that's a statement situated within something that I think people are going to have a positive association with, that I hope will make them more receptive to that idea. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's that simple. Other times it's much more confrontational. But the idea that there are a lot of people that are great at writing about politics and and looking at the just looking at how power structures exist and really analyzing all that, whether it's, you know, Noam Chomsky or Orwell or any number of people whose work I appreciate as writers, Matt Taibbi, mm-hmm. you know. And then there are people that paint amazing paintings. We were talking about Mark Ryden, absolutely astonishingly gifted painter. The paintings he does just are, you know, beyond my comprehension technically. But really, I relate to the Winston Smith, to the Jamie Reed, to the Raymond Pettibone, to the Robbie Canal. That's just what excites me. Barbara Kruger. Mm-hmm. That's the work that excites me the most. Do you guys know Barbara Kruger? I stole the Obey red box with white type in it from her. It's, yeah, straight up. Don't speculate. It's true.
And They Live.
They Live, the set design from John Carpenter's They Live, which is what inspired the use of the word Obey in my work. They were inspired by Barbara Kruger's work with the type style and the set design in They Live. So I was already a fan of Barbara Kruger, which then primed me to be that much more excited by They Live and that mm-hmm. much more attentive. And then I also loved Orwell. So,
and also, They Live had Rowdy Roddy Piper. Yeah.
Which, you know, Rowdy Roddy Piper being in that certainly was, this is kind of a goofy movie, but it's a really profound concept. And when I made the original Andre the Giant Has a Posse sticker, it was not intended to be profound at all. It was meant to be an inside joke with some hip-hop slang between five skateboard friends. Mm-hmm. But the reaction to it, and then my analysis of how people were responding to it, like a Rorschach test, and then I was already a fan of the Sex Pistols, who were big into situationist theory, the idea of people living in a trance and needing spectacles to snap them out of their routine and make them more sensitive. And then I discovered Heidegger's theory of phenomenology. Same idea, people need things that reawaken a sense of wonder about their environments because they become lazy and don't analyze things specifically, but look at things in more of an abstract way based on assumptions. All of that was really important to me. When I saw They Live, I was like, ooh, this has got an analogy to my project. It's sort of a B-movie about, you know, Rowdy Roddy. It's but it sneaks up on you because, have you guys seen the movie? Okay. So if you haven't, see it. They live, John Carpenter, you know, he did Escape from New York, he did Halloween.
Have you seen Escape from Los Angeles?
Terrible.
The follow-up from Escape from New York?
It's terrible.
It's arguably the worst movie ever made. It's so remarkably bad, because Escape from New York is amazing. So
you know how you should see everything with Steve Buscemi in it? Not everything.
Yeah. But you should see everything with Kurt Russell in it.
Yeah.
Especially Roadhouse.
Yeah. But anyway, yeah, they live, when Rowdy Roddy Piper puts on these special sunglasses, he realizes that half the world is run by aliens who have turned the human race into a sort of domesticated livestock that do their menial chores for them. And when you have the special glasses on, you can see that the advertisements say things like, consume, watch television, marry and reproduce, and obey. And when I saw the obey, I hadn't used any specific phrases with my work other than the original Andre the Giant has a posse, 7'4", 520 pounds. I thought, of all the things that people resist when told overtly to do it, but actually submit to when it's framed as, well, that's just how society works, that's the rules, that's what people expect. Obedience is a very, very tricky thing. But I liked the idea of forcing people to confront it rather than making excuses why they don't stand up for what they believe in. So obey was, I couldn't think of a word more fitting to my ideas than that, and it's been with me ever since.
It's funny, the Andre the Giant has a posse. I remember because I had a girlfriend who lived in Providence when you were at RISD,
right.
And so I started seeing the stickers then. I was like, well, those are interesting, and maybe this is something I shouldn't admit, but when I see Andre the Giant has a posse now, I think of his friends in The Princess Bride.
Yeah.
That's his posse.
Yeah.
They're all pals and they have adventures.
I mean, you know, the that's a brilliant movie. I mean, I love that movie. We become acquaintances with Cary Elwes, he's the main guy in that, and he has such great stories about how cool Andre was. And Andre, the thing that's fascinating about Andre is that, he played a villain as a wrestler, but apparently he was a really sweet guy, and the disease he had, acromegaly, is, it'll eventually kill you, like it did kill him, but he turned a liability into an asset, and the way a lot of people interpret him, I think, is sort of a reflection of their outlook. If they see him as scary and intimidating, that's their, they're a fearful person. If they see him as sweet, goofy, sympathetic, that's where they're coming from. So sometimes I'm just like, okay, so what do you think of the Andre sticker? And then it's like, okay, will I ever talk to you again? Yes or no after that.
And it's funny because I see the Misfit shirt over there.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember when I started seeing, I don't know if you did this or who did this, someone who started taking the Andre the Giant has a posse image that turned it, okay.
Yeah. Well, I love the Misfits and the idea of hijacking the cultural currency of anything that's maybe more ubiquitous than something I've done. I'll just say, you can hand that off to me now, I'll take it. I love punk rock, but a pretty interesting story about the Fiend Skull and the original Andre mashup was, my friend works for Ozzy Osbourne, and he loves the Misfits, and he's from New York. I did a
Your
show.
Your friend or Ozzy?
We know Ozzy also, but no, my friend, I don't know if Ozzy's a big Misfits fan, but no, my friend Big Dave, he loves the Misfits. He's from New York. I did a show at the CBGB's 313 Gallery right next door to CBGB's in the 90s.
It's now a Patagonia store.
Yeah, and John Varvatos is next door. Mm-hmm. Dave came to that show, and he introduced himself and said he really liked my work. And then shortly after that, he started working for Ozzy. And we ran into each other again, and he said, and he'd gotten a couple of tattoos of my work, but he said, you know, I want my next tattoo. I was thinking, you know, kind of a mixture of the original Andre head and the Misfits fiend skull. You know, that would be,
ding.
And he was like, you know, would you design it for me? And that same week, I got introduced to the Misfits manager and to Jerry Only from the Misfits. And I didn't want to do this thing unless he wouldn't be offended by it because, you know, I love the Misfits. And
Jerry's one of the brothers, right?
Yeah, yeah. It's Doyle and Jerry.
And they're like 17 feet tall.
Yeah, yeah. And they're big guys. I don't want to piss them off. So so I talked to them, and Jerry was like, I love your stuff. You know, do it. And so I made that image. Dave never got the tattoo of it, but I made posters and stickers.
Hmm. Yeah. By the way, isn't there supposed to be a Q&A when... Oh, okay.
All right.
So in 5 minutes or for 5 minutes? Okay. Here's the question that I think everyone here would like to know the answer to. What was it like being represented on The Simpsons?
Well, you know, when I was first out of college, I started my screen printing studio in Providence while I was in school because I fell in love with the medium. It was, you know, it was what Warhol used. It was what punk rockers used. It, you know, it was a way to make multiples that were affordable. I could make stuff to give to friends, sell, put up on the street. It was very utilitarian. And when I got out of school, and that was going to be, you know, the way I made my living, I got to do some cool jobs like stickers for Sonic Youth, but mostly it was printing T-shirts for, you know, local restaurants or karate uniforms and, you know, terrible stuff where I made like $3 for a day's worth of work. And I worked really hard because I had this vision of having a factory space. I had a skateboard ramp in my studio and bands would practice there sometimes. And you know, I thought like, you know, any day like the Velvet Underground are going to stop by and Leo Castelli's going to give me a big show and, you know, that's...
Jim Morrison's going to have sex with Nico.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. But it wasn't happening and I was barely surviving, so I worked 7 days a week. And I had a couple of friends that worked for me and, you know, helping to print and fold shirts and cut stickers. You know, every one of those several hundred thousand early Andre stickers were cut by hand with a paper cutter, scissors, or an X-Acto knife in my studio or in my house on a coffee table while I watched They Live or Kiss mm-hmm. videos, or Melvin's videos. But but the only break I would take was Sunday night to watch The Simpsons. This is my ritual. In the 90s, from like about 94 to, you know, several years. Sunday night, watch The Simpsons and eat dinner with some friends. And I like to have a beer now and then, but I was so poor I couldn't afford alcohol. So like Sunday night, we'd get something, you know, like Schaefer.
Mm-hmm. And pre-sobriety, I like Schaefer a lot.
Yeah. But, and then we'd play a couple games of pool. But so when they asked me to be a guest character on The Simpsons, it was really touching. It was really meaningful because, you know, when you think about like there are a lot of things that I wanted to do, a lot of music shows I wanted to see I couldn't afford, but I never missed The Simpsons.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was pretty cool. And you know, hanging out with Matt Groening and him saying, you know, thanks for making my show cooler. Like, that's mm-hmm. that's definitely not true, and thanks. I'm not worthy, but anyway.
Was that the episode that had? I believe it was like there was the Banksy directed opening.
Yeah, it was shortly after that. So Banksy did that, and that was amazing mm-hmm. Because he just. Tore Fox apart for, you know.
Have you seen the opening, the Banksy directed?
Amazing. But, you know.
Killing the poor
they
little
loved
panda.
All the writers from The Simpsons loved Exit Through the Gift Shop. So they did the Banksy thing, and then they asked me to be in Exit Through the Quickie Mart. And but they sent me the script, and the idea is, you know, Bart falls in love with street art, and he's doing these posters of Homer, which are a mixture between, you know, the Hope poster and Obey, and they say dope, and it's Homer in the thing, and Homer's driving around like, I feel sorry for the idiot whose picture's all over the place. But they sent me the script, and they asked me for notes, and there's a part where I'm supposed to, it ends up that I'm working for the Springfield Police Department as an undercover cop to catch taggers. Yeah, unfortunately, that's outed me, and I have to run for my life now. God, yeah. And there were rumors that, he really is. He admitted he's a narc. But the politics of graffiti culture we won't get into right now. But they send a thing, and my line was supposed to be, I discover Bart and Milhouse putting up stencils in an alleyway, and I go. Hey guys, I've been checking out what you've been doing, and I think I could get you an art show, a show for your street art in a gallery, and they're like, and who are you? And I say Shepard Fairey, and they're like, who? And I'm like, you know, Obey the Obama poster, and they're like, never heard of it. But I said, Bart should say back to me, well, if it's in a gallery, wouldn't it be a gallery show, not a street art show? Mm-hmm. And they added that in.
Yeah.
And because that leads right into the question I'm almost always asked. So whoever was going to ask it, sorry, I'm answering it now. Don't you think that street art is going to be declawed, be tamed by being in the elitist institutions you once claimed to push back against? And it's not street art when it's in a gallery or a museum. Street art is its own thing, and I love it. I love public art because it exists where people live their lives. And whether it's legal or illegal, the idea that it creates a conversation in a context that's usually reserved for commercial communication and government signage and bland, blank things is so exciting to me and so important. But album packaging, skateboard graphics, t-shirts, galleries, museums, what's in the background on a television show, there's so many different amazing platforms for how people can experience art, design, creative visual communication. So I've never labeled myself a street artist, and I still do street art. I love street art, but it's just one way to satisfy my objective of democratizing art. And I think that the best way to put it is that I've employed the inside-outside strategy, where when the system's not providing any way for me to get the results I want, I work outside the system. I mean, the way that Black Flag created a touring circuit for hardcore bands in the 80s that then Husker Du and the Minutemen and everybody followed. Blaze your own trail. But if you have the opportunity to infiltrate the system, change it for the better from within, and be subversive while people don't think you're any threat at all, that's fucking awesome. So, and I'll do that too.
Yeah.